So my talk will be divided into five parts. First, I will talk about morality and markets, why morality should be placed within markets or should not be placed within markets, and what it means, entrepreneurship in the context of Islam, and I would like to give a little bit historical perspective in relation to Islamic economic institutions. Then we'll move on to Central Asia and talk about this dual transformation. What is dual transformation? On the one hand, it's a transformation economically from collectivist state-controlled mechanism towards capitalism, some form of capitalism. And on the other hand, it's a moral transformation, from Marxism and Soviet teaching, supposedly Homo Sovieticus, towards a person, personality, that where religion has now increasingly a place in personal and social life. So it is what I call a dual transformation. And I will provide a recent survey evidence, relatively recent, not very timely in some ways, but I think will give us an understanding of how Islam is being interpreted by different ethnic groups in Central Asia in relation to doing business. And I would like to provide some conclusions. In relation to morality and markets, I would like to go back to the philosophy of understanding morality and trying to place morality within the context of our evolutionary being. So Amartya Sen wrote a critical view on how economists have actually misinterpreted morality in relation to markets. And he suggested that we have critical reasoning and morality embedded in our economic exchanges as well as consequences of those actions. Similarly, there are those who argued that against relativity, that moral norms actually are part of our being, and we can indeed talk about moral entitlement, moral existence, perhaps not always relation to religion, but relation to our self, our existence and being. Cultural disharmony has been discussed in relation to moral disharmony, that in societies that do not have a degree of moral sharing and understanding tend to suffer from cultural disharmony as well. Hence, states are being associated with harmonizing morals within their jurisdiction. And Amartya Sen and others have argued that morality is a universal thing, that all of us have moral sentiments. These are subject to biological and behavioral evolutionary changes that we have gone through. Hence, it has been shaped by our understandings and experiences. Hall Pike also introduced the term of moral comprehension, trying to actually highlight the fact that our understanding also goes through our moral comprehension about our actions, about other people's actions, and about our experiences. But free market thinkers and neoliberals have persistently actually argued that a perfectly competitive market should be free from morality, i.e. Markets promote freedom through open participation and separation of powers. Hence, it promotes liberties and freedoms. I give a rough example. For example, individuals, instead of exchanging with their kin and relatives or bloodline people in a competitive free market, would be encouraged to make exchanges with people whom they don't know. And that's the ideal notion of freedom, separation of powers. Hence, liberty, impartiality, and optimality of perfectly competitive markets form a morally free zone, and that has been argued on and on by economic liberal thinkers. So idealized and benign notion of free markets in liberal economic theory actually shied away from debating morality in relation to self-interested individual, as well as the notion of liberty. Now, I would like to move on with this discussion towards what we understand about entrepreneurship, whether entrepreneurship studies and understanding about the entrepreneurial actions can be seen through the prism of morality. Now, I propose that actually entrepreneurs are not like ordinary individuals. They are subject to more morally challenging decision-making and action processes, because they may be frequently violating some of the most common moral standards and understandings. In fact, some scholars, now died out, nobody is actually talking about this beyond business ethics, argued that maybe ordinary morals do not apply to business doing. In fact, in the early 1940s, well, 38, Barnard wrote this interesting article about doing business and bluffing. So he suggested that entrepreneurs, unlike ordinary people, tend to bluff frequently because it's advantageous for them to do so. In fact, if I may extend this to the recent financial crisis in terms of manipulation of information, bluffing built into the financial system really explains us how entrepreneurship worked in relation to distorting or manipulating information. So I think that's a very interesting area that one could look at in relation to entrepreneurship. Another maybe less controversial aspect is innovation. Innovation is about deviation, and if you go off track from the mainstream understandings and interpretations, you are also an entrepreneur, are exploiting possibilities of doing things differently. So in a way, innovation comes from deviation, hence that deviation also is about deviating from the common practices of doing right and wrong. Looking at the way in which enterprise and religion have evolved over the centuries under different modern codes tells us that until recent secularization movements, enterprise actually have evolved along with and within religious practices. Buddhism in Japan, the idea of Protestant work ethic and its practices, Islam and Islamic institutions. Of course, business deviated on and off from this religious domain and teaching, but frequently business actually has evolved in relation to with religion, from the early Mesopotamian civilizations to monotheistic religions. And within that, I think we can see also ontological relationship between work as a worship. Hence, different religious practices have looked at work in relation to worshiping, in relation to also preserving order and obedience in relation to the power structures. Hence, religion became institutionalized in preserving that order and in preserving the work as worship in relation to state power. So we stop and we slowly move a beautiful volcanic lake in Kyrgyzstan. So let's look at the relationship between Islam. What we have today is, everybody knows, no secret, that majority Muslim countries are economically more backward than perhaps average rest of the world, depending on, of course, better performing countries removed perhaps, like Saudi Arabia, oil-rich countries, Turkey, which had early modernization. If you remove these outliers, the table we have, according to UNDP figures, according to other indicators, the picture does not look very bright. Why then? Why the Islamic world has stagnated economically, especially after having been at the forefront of Islamic science, discoveries, trade, One explanation is given by economists here. Kuran is the leading expert in the field. He says that there was issue about the stagnation in supply of entrepreneurship in relation to Islamic institutions, which have not changed or responded according to the changing needs. So his idea here is that Islamic contract law, contractual practices of merchants and producers, as well as other judiciary practices, have not changed over the centuries. And his evidence comes from about 300 year assessment of business practices and judicial cases he observed in the Ottoman Empire. Another significant argument in his analysis is that the notion of corporation did not emerge within this Islamic institutional system. Its emergence late. Hence, rather than impersonal, personal exchanges have been maintained. Sabri Gülgener, another economist, actually looked at this decline, relative economic decline, in particular along the Silk Road, in relation to a moral decline. And he examined the lores and songs and other sources to suggest that this decline was a mental and moral decline, and the economic decline came afterwards. I would like to look at Islamic institutions here because when we talk about Islam in Central Asia and practice of business in relation to Islam, what do we mean by that? Well, there are certain Islamic institutions that have been in existence throughout centuries. One of the most important of those are wakfs. Wakfs today are almost non-existent or distorted in existence, but they were very strong social and personal forms of capital accumulation, and they also were involved in social provision. So in that sense, it was an institution that had certain advantages over other capitalist forms, but they did not transform into corporations. So that's one interesting question, why it didn't happen. I can talk about it more later during the discussion. We don't have much time. Another dimension of it, because of the lack of impersonal institutions, most of Islamic businesses and trade and overseas expansion often happened in relation to personal contracts. And of course, there is this notion of interest-free trade, i.e., for a long time, interest was a major problem in economic exchanges. Of course, interest rate was banned also in other major religions. The fact that Islam approached it more in a more orthodox way is maybe a sideline issue. But if we look at the conversions of Islam in Africa and other places, we see it had happened in relation to trade routes. So having a more advanced accounting, more advanced legal system and a trust built into these institutions actually facilitated not only trade between lands, but also facilitated conversions. So conversions in Africa took place in relation to these trade routes, which have been well articulated by Ansminger, looking at also in comparison to Christian versus Islamic groups between several African states. Now, I would like to talk very briefly about why Islamic institutions have declined in relation to this internal reasons, the lack of change in personal exchanges to impersonal, very late or rather non-emergence of the notion of corporation, stagnation of wakf system as wealth accumulation rather than distribution for innovative entrepreneurial activities. There are, of course, other explanations, which some dismiss, but I think they are still part of the external environmental circumstances that perhaps Islamic institutions have not been strong enough to overcome. these related to do the destruction of Baghdad, which was a very important learning center in the 13th century, Western colonial expansion and capitulations, which actually helped to facilitate this growing gap between Muslim and non-Muslim communities in different parts of the Mediterranean. In fact, Ottoman historians show that for about 200 years, non-Muslims got wealthier and wealthier compared to the Muslim subjects of the empire, who took mostly bureaucracy, army, and agrarian activities, while non-Muslim subjects have taken entrepreneurial trade and manufacturing-related opportunities. So there had been this growing specialism and deepening gap between that wealth accumulation. Another interesting dimension is the legal plurality, that non-Muslims were allowed to use European courts as well as Muslim courts if they needed to, whereas the Muslim subjects always preferred Islamic courts, hence lost the opportunity of taking case into whatever favorable situation they might have. Again, egalitarian Muslim inheritance system, which looks morally right, but in a way facilitated again division of wealth among siblings, because Islamic inheritance law is egalitarian in its core. Practices may vary, but reality is that it allows breaking up the wealth. Financial crisis in the Ottoman Empire was considered to be another factor. Scientific decline and stagnation from 12th centuries onwards, which meant that scholars and theologists kept repeating the older work rather than writing new ideas and new findings. So this moral stagnation maybe is also another linked factor here. Low urbanization and entrepreneurship has been detected as another phenomenon. And finally, slave armies' use, which allowed also weak local powers. The central power preferred using slave armies at the expense of local powers, and hence weak local powers delayed the emergence of plural civil society and emergence of merchant and entrepreneurial classes as actors, as powers between the state and other segments of the society. So this is of course a complex picture, but will help us to understand where we start in Central Asia today in relation to the emergence and diffusion of Islam and Islamic practices. What is actually economic aspect of Islam in terms of its institutions in Central Asia today? That's why I think that we should start from that standing point. So, Islam and capitalism today are in double transformation in relation to the current changes. We know that Silk Road had enormous prosperity. It was a mixing pot for different civilizations. Today, it is a backwater. It is subject to other competing new projects. What we have today is mostly Islamic institutions that are informal and informalized in practice, and early history of Islam in the region has to do also with, again, how the Soviet expansion eliminated modernist forces within Islam. So we are starting from a further backward stage, because that modernization efforts through Jadids and other movements have been basically eradicated by the Soviet system. Thus, we have a big gap in the understanding and interpretation of Islam due to this this gap. Today, Islam in the region and in terms of entrepreneurial practices emerged as an ideology, because it is substituting Soviet practice. It's a tool of propaganda. It's a welfare provision, and it's also a source of personal moral energy. I will skip the market economy points and would like to talk to you about this evidence of new Muslim bourgeoisie and their relation to Islamic work ethic and work working and laboring. And in my earlier work, I developed the typology of Soviet rationality, Sufism, and Orthodox Islam, linking to different practices of rationality versus utopia. In a recent survey, this is, by the way, the first time I'm presenting this because it has been sitting in my shelf for a while, I did a project in Bishkek, Osh, Nokat, including two Dungan and one Uyghur villagers with 21 business owners, looking at how entrepreneurs interpret Islamic practices, piety, and doing business. And I'm grateful to Social Research Center of the University of Central Asia that hosted the work. So there is this Islamic work ethic, which is based on norms. We are Muslims, everything is written on our forehead. Pious men do not take unlawful share from others. And the other one continues along the same lines. And it says, our business volume has been growing because of our reputation based on these morals. Untrustworthy. When we go to bazaar, if we see a Russian trader, we prefer him or her. We know the Muslim traders tend to cheat. He or she may charge you more, give bad quality product, or tamper with the weight. Some claim that Islam is the only right way, but look at Russian. He's not a Muslim. Islam is not something superior to me. He lies. Dungans and Uyghurs are habitual liars. I transliterated into Turkish, it was closer, hep yalancıdır. Russians are more honest. I don't like people telling lies. There are Kyrgyz who tell lies as well, but these are known very quickly. Uyghurs and Uzbeks lie for money. He is idle. In 1993, Russians left, the system collapsed, and the factory stopped producing. We did not have a Kyrgyz factory working class. Russians did everything. Kyrgyz did not know how to work. I think this is really very important. Kyrgyzlar çalışmayı bilmezdi. Kyrgyz could not live in Bishkek without registration, but Russians would get homes, registration, and settle easily here. He's a communist. I'm a communist, but practice Islam too. Religion and business should be kept apart. These are difficult times to do business. There is corruption, bribery, and economic hardship. There are moments when you cannot do clean business. Then you worship and ask God to forgive you. In conclusion, I have to be fast here. What we see is the emerging social organization for work and exchange that has to be different from the Soviet teachings. And I think these quotes have illustrated the dilemmas of trust, work, understanding work, and knowing how to work. Another phenomenon in relation to both interpretation of Islam and entrepreneurship is that there is almost no entrepreneurial genealogies in the region. Only some artisan families around Fergana Valley can trace back business work, doing work to their family history, but many others don't have any understanding or family background in doing business, which is very important because there is a knowledge gap, there is a human capital gap today. There are huge day-to-day moral dilemmas. It is difficult to do business. So Islam provides actually a form of moral energy, but also personal justification at the same time. So there is still an appeal of Islam, despite the fact that it doesn't actually provide strong economic institutions. And this takes place under authoritarian kleptocracies in the region, especially, of course, in the context of my survey in Kyrgyzstan. So we really need, I will finish with two questions. We need to have new enlightened interpretations. We also need new research directions. And I finish with an Uzbek proverb. Rich man won't stop to lie down. A man with some wealth is too restless to sleep. Yet the poor one doesn't want to wake up from his dreams.